a late one today, and welcome to this week's dose of wealth wisdom, or Wednesday dose of wealth wisdom. Apologies, I'm doing it a bit later, as I said I would, as I decided to go for a run. But we'll get the content out there, and today's topic is going to be how you make your money is more important than how much you make. So give me a minute, and I'll share it to the relevant places, and we can begin. I tell you what, I've been off for 10 days, so I'm busy catching up, and I just went for a run, and by God, I've lost it pretty quickly, so I'll be getting it back on. There we go. Let me share this. Right, so we can begin. Let's make sure we're not on mute. Okay, good. Hello, and thank you for joining us for this week's Wednesday Dose of Wealth Wisdom with me, Daniel Kennedy, your host, Wealth Dragon coach and CEO of the KML Group and Home Hug Limited. Today's topic is a discussion and something that's really, really close to my heart, and it is how you make your money is more important than how much you make. And what do I mean by this? In today's world, information is everywhere. Everyone's going to know what you do, whether you want them to or not. They might not say it to your face, but if you're an honest person or if you're a dishonest person, perhaps you're like a little intimidating, perhaps. So they'll tell you what you want to hear. But deep down, they know whether you're making your money in an ethical way or an unethical way. And even if you're doing it in an ethical way, some people will still find the time to criticize you because they will think that you're doing it in an unethical way. Why is this important? Because people's perception of you, especially if you're raising finance and you're wanting to have potentially a business that's scalable, you're not going to be able to do it on your own. And making money, honestly, you won't make as much as someone who would be callous, for example. And I'll give you an example. Once you get good at raising money, you can raise as much as you want. Like, you could just keep raising it and not have deals to place it into. But to do it honestly, you need to have deals to place it into that make a return, so then you can pay your investors back. But if I was callous, if I was just wanting to make a quick buck, I could quite easily raise £1 million and then run off somewhere, and I would be pretty much set for life, and there wouldn't be a thing that anybody could do about it. So when you have... But obviously, I'm never going to do that because I recognize money tomorrow is not as valuable as money in the future. So having people around me who hold me to account, and also what I do, to really, really force myself not to frivolously spend. I'm forever saying that it's foolish to spend money on depreciating assets. And I constantly talk about like having a really, really solid mindset when it comes to finance. So if I break it, I look really stupid publicly, and no one wants to look stupid. So what I'm saying is, even if it's going to cost you money, for you to keep your word, or for you to maybe rescind on a deal when somebody wants to, and just be that person that is an honest person, get a reputation for being an honest person, because the moment you start to do things dishonestly, it all comes crumbling away. So I can tell you example time and time and time again of people who've made a bit of money and suddenly turned into an absolute bell end and screwed the people who helped them on the way up. Because, and then what happens on the way down, there's nobody to stop them falling, and they end up on their ass on their own with no contents, no backups, and no one to help them. And a prime example is the bloody builders that I use. I had a team. I was willing to just constantly give them work, and I wanted that. Good for me, good for them. They get wealthy on the deals. I get less stress on having a good team. But made a bit of money. First deal, great. Second deal, great. Third deal, started to slip. Fourth deal, a complete shambles. And now I'm not going to hire that person, but all his staff is contacting me, wanting to continue to work for me. So the announcement, because I finally made it to 1,000 likes, which is great, is as of tomorrow, because I'm sick to death of builders and main contractors letting me down because they don't have the same sort of ethics and the morals, and they don't have the right attitude when it comes to money, is I'm starting a construction company. And it's going to be completely within the group, the KML group, to do our own deals and other people's works. And I'm going to control all the finance from it. I'm going to make sure that the guys get paid. And it's going to be a slow burn, but hopefully they'll become fairly wealthy from it. And I wouldn't be able to do this or even think of entering this business if anyone thought that I was dishonest, because now I'm going to be in control of even more money. More people are going to be trusting me on potentially their one HMO or their one extension or their one kitchen. And if I was to screw that person over, so say if I go and quote a job, we make a mistake and then we try and make the client pay for it, that will have a compound effect, and so will doing the right thing by them. Say for example, we decide to pay for our initial and we lose money on the job, or if the deal goes awry and potentially we've got more money stuck in, like we are the last ones to get paid, so the investors then decide, right, these are good guys, we may have lost money together, but they did their best to try and get the funds back. I'm going in many directions here because it's such an important thing. And there's so many vehicles that you can use to make money, good and bad. So like drug dealers, you see them around the town, you immediately know if they are a drug dealer, just because of their whole persona. And it's very easy to judge someone by his looks, I think. Like, so easy. You know if somebody's doing it ethically or unethically, regardless of all the things out there that people say, oh, this person, you shouldn't judge a book by its cover. Absolutely. You know deep down, and everyone else around you knows if you're a good person or a bad person, just by how you deal with people who aren't able to give you anything in return. If you're just generally nice to people, that's always a good thing. And having lines in the sand as well. I've turned away more business than I've accepted because I won't work with people who will screw people over, because life's hard enough. So like our main builder, again, second time around, main contractor, we had an electrician. I don't know why he did this. It was for such a small sum. And the electrician did the work pro bono. So that means he did it without being paid up front, because the connection was via me. So I don't like to do recommendations because people don't know how to manage people in most cases. It's very rare you find that a person who can manage people really well. Usually they're too kind and they don't have enough lines in the sand, and then they get taken advantage of, because most people will try and they'll think about tomorrow and not the future. That's why most of us are poor, because we're thinking about tomorrow's payday and not the future. And it's all a choice. So if you can reorientate your mind to have delayed gratification, you'll end up having a better life, trust me. And so this gentleman he did the work, got the certificates, and then decided not to pay the electrician. And the jobs that I was giving him were £90,000, probably £10,000 of that was profit. So this guy was in short of a few quid. And purely from that, because there was a small cable that just used this guy, he lost me as a person who was going to hire him. He lost somebody else as a person who was going to hire him. And for us alone, we're doing 7 HMOs this year. So that's 7 jobs, roughly about 32 rooms to 38 rooms, depending on what we get planning. But that's a contract of maybe £400,000, of which maybe 20-30% would have been profit, as well as his own wages. And that's from me alone. And purely because of this, I now tell everyone about this person because of how unethical it is. Like, you need to make sure people get paid, regardless of whether they're your guys or somebody's subby or somebody who's doing your cleaning or your garden. Because if somebody's done the work, it's really, really unethical. And mud sticks, what you've got to realize, guys, you're not going to get away with it. Like, it's so important that you are an honest, ethical and moral person when it comes to money, because you've got to have in the back of your mind. So say somebody is a trade and maybe they're on 150 a day. So they've exchanged their time for money. So then time's only finite. When you're an investor like ourselves, we're planting like money seeds here and there and everywhere. Like, money's going to have less value to us because we know how to make it. We've got the skill to make it. And it's not very easy to turn yourself into a person that can, one, hold wealth, because that's just as hard as making it. And you'll realize when somebody maybe has a really successful year, i.e. the builders, and then they lose the hunger. I don't understand. Like, they make like 100K, I think that's fantastic, I've made £100,000. And then the hunger goes. Suddenly they start turning up at 10 o'clock instead of 7 o'clock. Suddenly they start leaving at 3 o'clock instead of 4 o'clock. And I sat down with my builder, for example, on the last job, and I said, listen, you're charging me day rate and you're doing 6 hours. There'll be a time where I won't mention it and I'll just go find somebody else. And that's exactly what I've done now. And this person, he's messaging me saying, oh, is there any more jobs, any more work? Because he's burnt out his luck. He's hurt the people below him. He's hurt his colleagues. And now he's hurt the hand that feeds him just by his attitude of thinking about the money tomorrow and instead of money in the future. Excuse me. I got really dry throat because I've been running very slowly. And I know, like, once you start to, the temptation's always going to be there. The temptation is going to be to palm off a crap deal to somebody who doesn't know what they're doing. It's so hard to fight that temptation, let me tell you. Because, like, for instance, I source £1,000 a room deals to people. So that's quite expensive. And there were so many scenarios where I could have, because they completely and totally put your trust in you. Once your reputation is that you are a fairly trustworthy guy, you pay people back, you're seen not to be really, really sort of extravagant, and you explain the reasons why, even though you're making quite a lot of money, people will just trust you with huge sums of money. And we're all human. The temptation is so strong. And that's why you should never have absolute power. Having a business partner is great. Having checks and balances is great, because we're all human. And realizing absolute power means absolute corruption. And there's 100% that, for instance, if I had had that person's experiences, that collection of experiences, I would be doing exactly the same as that person. And if he had my experiences, he would be in my position and doing the exact same thing as what I'm doing, because we're all just a collection of experiences. So you have to see yourself as somebody who can be influenced, somebody who isn't perfect, because none of us are, and then you have to put checks and balances on yourself so you never get tempted. Because there might be the time, like, for instance, we have like cash everywhere and not hardly any of it's ours, but it'd be so easy to just take a bit out and go and spend it. It would be so easy, but we have checks and balances, so it would get found out immediately, like within days. And so this is going to be a fairly quick one today. It may be really, really hard, and you may not be making much money, and you may get the opportunity to make the quick buck, to get in there, screw somebody over, maybe give them a bad deal, because there are a lot of people doing this. And there's a few that have come to me, and like, I haven't been able to help them because the deals have been that bad, because somebody has tried to make a quick buck. And I know who sold them the deal, and I'm telling everyone who sold them the deal, and they'll never work in this area of the market. And I'm speaking from somebody who, when I first started, I was in Hartlepool, and I was so like, I was wanting to make money as fast as I can. And we did something that was really unethical, and it just stopped my journey in Hartlepool. I had to go somewhere else because it was a complete knobhead move. I wasn't partly to blame because I didn't know it was happening. But I had a business partner who's in a band now, funnily enough. He took a slightly different direction to property. And I was away with work. He got a deal brought to him. We were happy with the numbers. But then he went round the sourcer and went to the property directly and made like an offer £1,000 or £2,000 cheaper. And this only really came to light after. And that was purely because he didn't have any checks and balances. He was a very honest person. Like, I don't think he would have done this if we just discussed it. And then obviously we lost the deal because the sourcer had a great relationship with the vendor. And it was absolutely horrendous. It blew up on Facebook like it does whenever somebody else does something dishonest, because everyone likes a bad story, don't they? Like, the good stories, they're like, oh, well done, but they're a bit boring. But God, we like looking under the rock when we've squished something and be like, oh, God, it's so fascinating. But we still look, right? And we don't know why. It's just something that humans do. A bad story will sell way more than a good story, because that's like clickbait, the whole culture now. And so I came to Birmingham with a very different philosophy, and it's been slow. It's still slow, because although from the outside it looks fairly good that we've got multiple properties, we're making net profits, really great net profits, but it's not all ours. We've lent money to do all this and build this portfolio. So every penny we make is being saved up to pay the investors back. And we've had one deal that went completely tits up because I believed the 20 grand cheaper Romanian would have done better than my previous builder. And I went cheap. And if you go cheap, you pay twice. But again, with that person, he worked really hard in the beginning. He could have got us as contractors and he would have had £400,000 worth of contracts. But he thought about the money tomorrow instead of the money in the future. And he did a poor job. And this can be, this isn't just in property. This is in every industry. Like wealth is a slow burn. Like you're going to see videos and you're going to see movies and maybe news articles or YouTube videos. Yeah, you'll get financially free in a year. You're not going to. You're not going to, because even if like there's cycles in property, you don't know whether your business is resilient enough in a downward cycle. Like, is demand going to drop out? Is it going to, no one's going to rent your rooms or anything? Do you have the reserve funds to maybe switch them back to flats or switch them back to single lets? Or for the new hungry people that come up, are you able to fight them off and keep the clients? Like, it's an ever-changing business. So having people, especially when you become successful, I don't know why some people do this. More people do it than don't for some reason. They turn the back on the people that train them. So there's like people within our circle that have actually become complete ballers. And then I have a chat with them and they're slagging off the coaches for some reason. I don't know why. And there are people who like require help and then they learn the knowledge and they package it up and they sell it themselves without giving credit to the people they've learned it from. And most of the time it's subpar knowledge because they haven't taught about all the nuances. And for a very, 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 very long time, I thought that I was really resilient to go in to help people teach. But knowing, like, even if you learn something small, you can still help people behind you. It's whether you're going to charge them an arm and a leg for it. And really, I don't think you should in the beginning stage, because you're not experienced when you've got 4 years in property. Yeah, absolutely not. I've only got 4 years. You're not experienced when you've got 7 years or 10 years. Your only experience, in my view, is if you've survived a downward cycle. Because I've chatted to people during that period. And if you've been really cutthroat and you haven't helped those around you, in the hard times, people are going to leave you because it's human nature. There'll be very few people around you in the tough times, even if you do it honestly, even if you're ethical. But if you do it dishonestly, people will actively try and hamper your business, try and cut the legs from beneath you. And I've seen it. I've seen it and spoke to people on the receiving end of somebody who's taking out their business, somebody who's I don't think I should say it. Oh, screw it. So there's somebody who's selling a rent-to-rent portfolio, and this is how powerful like sort of like third party gossip is. And he said, I didn't want to sell it to this guy because I knew he's a bit dodgy. And I said the name. I've never met this guy, but I know he operates in our area. Never met him at all. Said the name, goes, yeah, that's the guy. And that's how powerful it is. And now in this rent-to-rent portfolio, he's brought some potential deals to me. There's going to be some great, great returns from it. And he's only come to me purely because he knows I'm not going to go around the back of him. I'm going to pay the house. I'm making $20,000 now and keeping my reputation intact is so much more beneficial in the long run than making £50,000 now and maybe tarnishing my reputation. Because you can lose trust in the moment. Like you don't pay, for instance, you don't pay a trade. He's never going to work for you again if you pay him for 2-3 days late without a reason. If you don't pay your sourcer, for instance, they're never going to source you a deal again. And the next deal may have like £30,000-£40,000 of equity, £50,000 of equity, £60,000 of equity, whatever it may be. And also having lines in the sand. Most people they'll just sit back and they won't say no when something is wrong. Or they won't say that, like they won't like push people back and say, "Listen, this is wrong. You need to." And they'll do the thing that where they want an easy life. They'll maybe watch the crime from across the road and not really get involved, or they'll allow people to maybe perhaps break the law and not call them out on it. And as soon as, like most people, if somebody is in front of you, for instance, well, I know somebody who's doing a 7-bed and a 6-bed, and immediately I was like, "Listen, you fucking naughty boy, why are you doing that?" And then it was like, but still, if he was telling me the deal, I'd probably be reporting him. I told him that. and you're going to come across this all the time. Every single person is going to try and bend the rules, break the rules, and not do it in a legit manner. But if you're the person who's doing it in a legit manner, getting all your licenses, doing the really, really laborious, boring stuff that isn't going to make you money, that isn't going to cost, it's going to cost you a lot of time. You can't get the nice photograph that'll be good for marketing, because most of the businesses, it's 95% boring, mundane, answering questions, doing really dull things. But those are the things that make you money. Those are the parts of the business that keep it turning. And seeing yourself as somebody who will do everything. So when I say how much money you make is more important than how much you make, this is primarily aimed at you guys and girls wanting to raise finance. So if you're raising finance, but then you're outsourcing all your work and you're not learning to do the stuff yourself, what does that say to an investor? It says, even if they don't say it or think it, they're going to see it in comparison to somebody who, like me, for example. If there's something that I can do, that I can also pay a trade to do, I will go and do it myself. Whether that unblock a toilet, I usually look at every single repair and see if I can do it first to try and save money. Because what that says in an investor's eyes is that if stuff goes wrong, I'm not going to bail and I'm going to at least try and sort it out. And that I'm not living extravagantly on their money, because they're lending me money. And if I'm then going off on really, really extravagant holidays, buying fast cars, and instead of being methodical and really sharing what I'm doing, whether it be a broken toilet or painting a wall or putting a bit of new skirting on, it's really easy to pitch to people and use that as a tool in your belt when you're raising finance to say, listen, it can't be right for me to go and enjoy the returns from the portfolio while we still owe people money. Every penny that we make goes back to paying the investors. So how do you survive in a scenario like that? That's why I wouldn't say you can become financially free in a year if you've got no money. You can source, raise finance, do a HMO, and then maybe if you source a bit more, pay off the investors, you've got one HMO. And that's what I did. I live off one HMO, and the rest, there's still all loans on. So we just build money, and then pay them back. In a few years, like delayed gratification, like, because as I say, it's more important how you make your money, and that is by helping people around you and making them money as well. And then the opportunities and the doors that will open will be so random, you just because you're an honest person and people see you as a good bet. But it's difficult for going from A to B. Once you get from the person who's trying to raise finance to somebody who's seen as an honest person who pays money back, you will have more money than you can spend. It's so hard to visualize, but I can tell you, you'll have more money than you can spend. And because you've adopted this persona and you've hopefully internalized being an honest person, you'll get to that point. And the reason why is because you won't want to put them in shitty deals, because your reputation is more important than your bank balance. And so you'll get in a position really quickly where you'll have more money than you can place in deals, because deals don't come along very often. Most people will say, oh, I can't raise finance. I'm really struggling to raise some finance. And they focus on the finance part, but having a deal that stacks and having a deal that can give a return and pay back the investor within, say, 2-3 years, and then for you to make a return, it's a good deal in my books. And those are the ones that are not very common. And people seem to, and when they get one, they undersell themselves because they haven't got the experience, they haven't got the credibility, and they also feel, so me charging, say, 7K for a sourcing fee, people are like, what, that's so expensive. I only charge 2, I only charge 5 or whatever. It's because I'm wholeheartedly believing that I'm giving that person a service, and it comes across in the way you sell. It comes across in the way you speak to people and your body, because how you say things is way more important than what you say. And you'll need to learn this if you're going to start selling as well. Selling people a service and really believing in the service, it's so much easier to sell something that you really believe will give that person a better standard of living, be it your accommodation, a better experience of the city, be it the area you pick it, or a better property journey, maybe selling the course or selling the apprenticeship or mentorship. So really believing, and don't bother selling products that you don't believe in, because it'll be a self-fulfilling prophecy. You'll feel that it isn't a good service, so that'll come across and people can tell. So therefore you'll make less sales, and then you'll believe it's less of a service, and then you'll make less sales. And when you're on that downward spiral, there's no real way of getting out of it. You just have to step away from it and start again on a different product or service. Right. These live videos are so annoying because I can't see any of the comments. Well, I'll have to answer them later. I'm sure you're all saying, fantastic, the moustache is back. I'm sure you're saying that. right, so my throat is hurting, so I'm going to go. If you've got any questions, and the reason why I've made this message is because I called someone out, and he was saying, oh, I want to really do well for children, and I want to lift your hand knives in, I'll give you free MMA lessons. And I know this person. He sells drugs to kids. Everyone does. People don't respect him. They fear him because he's a bit of a tough guy. And I just called him out, and then things blew up. And that person will get caught eventually, and that person will lose his sort of like economic engine. He's not going to be able to continue doing this for a long time. Whereas if he did it honestly and put his sort of like entrepreneurial sort of streak into something legal and ethical, it may take longer, may take 10 years longer, but it would, the compounding effect of doing it honestly would benefit him in such a way that he wouldn't even realize that in the long run, he'll be way wealthier, way more a resilient person, way more like valuable to society in 10, 30, 40 years time with the whole plethora of experience of just being involved in business than making the quick buck selling drugs. And people will genuinely tend to like you if you become a really great entrepreneur in the long run, because you become a person of abundance. You help people around you. It's not keeping them down. It's throwing the ladders down to try and get them back up with you. Because the more success isn't something that you take from somebody. It's something that you plant and it grows. And everyone around you hopefully becomes successful as well. They grow, he grows, and we grow. And it works that way. Right. That's all I've got for me, for you guys. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you want to listen to the previous episodes, do click the link. Now I'm going to go to bed.